This morning, I am very grateful for your critical attention. I'm currently working on a book on Paul, and as all of you know from working on your own books, it's a self-isolating experience. You end up muttering to yourself, talking to your monitor, and feeling very alone. So if I really look forward to getting your comments on this. The point of entry for the discussion is Paul. Paul figures as the premier Christian convert, the convert to Christianity, Acts of the Apostles and so on. And then he is the one who goes out and converts the empire, converts Gentiles to Christianity. I want to argue that the word conversion is terribly wrong to use in both those instances. I'll bracket Paul for the moment. I guess we'll be having an opportunity to consider Paul at some future point. But I want to talk particularly about the way that the word convert or conversions or converts imports anachronism and distortion into historical description for this period of the mid-first century. And the reason for that is not least of all because there really isn't such a thing as religion in antiquity. This is somewhat awkward for me to admit in public since my PhD is in fact precisely in religion in late antiquity. But religion doesn't exist as we think of it. It's not a detachable aspect of identity. I was taught in the 1970s that the situation of Mediterranean religions, it was a marketplace of all religions where one could pick and choose, and that in this marketplace of religions, there were aggressive Jewish missions to Gentiles, that idea that we see in Blumenkranz, that Marcel Simon appeals to explain Christian anti-Judaism and so on. So Hellenistic Judaism as a missionary religion. I think that idea has finally died on the vine. But in any case, this was something within living memory, such as my memory is, that I was trained in. And I think it's entirely wrong because in antiquity, and here comes the soundbite, the very first line of our handout on the first page. In antiquity, relations between heaven and earth are configured along ethnic lines. Gods are local both in terms of peoples and in terms of places, which means also that ethnic gods, and certainly the God of Israel, are ethnic as well. They attach to people. And it also means that in antiquity, another thing that can be confuse the idea of quote-unquote conversion, in antiquity all gods exist. All gods exist. You can posit different relationships between these different superpowers or extra-human powers. Some gods are bigger than others. Some gods are translocal in a way that smaller gods are not. But all gods actually exist. I want to also apologize for the translation of ethne. English gives wiggle room to the concept because you can properly translate the world either as Gentiles or as pagans. That exactly confuses the enterprise of looking at this period critically because gods and humans form family groups so that a Gentile is a pagan and a pagan is a Gentile. If people are intrinsically born into relations with their gods, there is no such thing as this ethnically neutral term that English has for Gentiles. It's all of these people. If you're a non-Gentile, if you're a non-pagan, then you're a Jew in this period. But that doesn't mean, of course, that you're uninvolved with the gods of other people as well. So in the situation of a superabundance of ethnic groups, remember, ethnic groups go on a city-by-city and valley-by-valley basis in antiquity, and you have a plethora of gods as well. So in terms of cult being one word that functions for what we think of as religion, cult, which is a formal way with inherited protocols for showing respect to the divine, whatever that, however you configure divinity. Cult is a kinship designation. And kinship is a cult designation. I have excerpts there both from Herodotus and many centuries later from Paul that configure cult and ethnicity almost identically. Very interesting. Herodotus says that kinship and therefore cult are not only synonymous, but he also says shared language as well in his list of identifiers. Paul, as a Hellenistic Jew, has to drop shared language as a kinship identifier, since Greek is one of the main Jewish languages in his period. But otherwise, he has the same types of identifiers for Jewishness as Herodotus did for Greekness. Paul says that his kinsmen according to the flesh, and the word for kinsmen is a family word, a shared blood word. To them belong the sonship, the glory, which is doxa in Greek, probably standing on top of the Hebrew kavod, and that is a reference to the temple. The covenants, the giving of the law, and the litreia, which translates avodah, which is an altar reference. So in giving his list of what sets his kinsmen apart, he lists almost exactly what Herodotus does. So religion, what we call religion, ancient people thought of as ancestral custom. I give a list of them there in Greek and in Latin. People are born into their obligations to their particular gods. And this begins with family gods and moves on up. Once Augustus promotes the worship of his genius in the empire, he positions himself as the pater familias of the empire. So not only are cities family-based religious institutions, the empire is, in a sense, a family-based religious institution, which is one of the reasons why dynastic shifts are as problematic as they are in the Roman Empire. Okay, so family relations between gods and people are literally that. Peoples are thought of as descending from their gods. I give here a list of things from Jewish ancestral writings because very often Jews are considered a special exception to these types of common Mediterranean ways of thinking. I want to say there that Israel is talked about as God's son, maybe not in as up close and personal a way as say Julius Caesar was descended from Venus, but there's this idea of a family relationship between gods and their humans. In terms of the citizens of a city being of one genos, it would be like talking about the race of the New Yorkers or the race of the Tel Avivians, which maybe we do. Cities are family-based religious institutions, so that in the book of the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 18, verse 24, a certain Eudaios named Apollos came to Ephesus. He was an Alexandrian by genos. That's an interesting mixed idea that the author of Acts gives. Given that this is a blood term, how many sets of biological parents can you have, right? One. And yet, even though he is of this one genos, namely of he's a Eudaios, by virtue of the fact that he's an Alexandrian, quote, by genos, that means he's an Alexandrian citizen. That's how naturally the biological idea of citizenship floats into the picture. Also, Appian's protest recorded in Josephus's Contra Appianum. If Jews want to be Alexandrian citizens, why don't they worship the same gods as the Alexandrians? It's a good question and a fair one. If you're part of the family, you are obligated to that family's gods. So realistically is this family connection between gods and their humans imagined that it is what motivates and articulates diplomacy between cities. in the Greco-Roman period. This is how cities negotiate treaties between them, is what they do is they will trace back, of course genealogies are always done backwards, but trace back ancestral relations until they get to a primal god who stands as a common ancestor between for these two people. I've quoted here an example of this Hellenistic kinship diplomacy that appears in Maccabees and also in Josephus. After reading a certain document, this is the Spartan king writing a letter to the Jewish high priest, we have found that Jews and Spartans are of one genos, one kinship unit, and they share a connection with Abraham. The Jewish God didn't date the way the Greek gods did, so Abraham had to be pressed into service. And it's a granddaughter of Abraham who marries Hercules, and this is one of the ways that Abraham becomes the father of many nations. There's also a tradition that traces back to the Table of the Nations in Genesis 10 with all their languages. All the nations are related through common descent from Noah's three sons. And so when Paul says that God will redeem the full number, the pleroma of the nations and all Israel, when he's saying pleroma of the nations, he's not just sort of waving his hand at all those outsiders out there. He's thinking in terms of the number 70, which relates to that table. Jews knew that other gods existed. They encountered other gods, first of all, in their own scriptures. But secondly, they encountered gods in their cities of residence, since cities are family-based religious institutions. Diaspora Jews in the West lived within a pagan religious institution if they lived within a diaspora city. This is just a handful of, I don't know, is six a handful? A smidge more than a handful of collections of just different bits and pieces of samples where ancient Jews show respect to gods that are not their own by blood, but they're still gods and they still need to be shown respect. Moskos Judaios is one of my favorites, because he leaves an inscription in the temple of these two gods who appeared to him in a dream saying that he should free his slave. And so he, when a god says jump, it doesn't matter whose god it is in antiquity, the only correct response is to ask how high. And Moskos does this, but he identifies himself, lucky for me, as Judaios in the inscription that he puts in the temple of these other gods. Herod the Great, of course, has a special day job. He has to show respect to foreign gods. It's part of his glorification of his nation that he also builds temples to other gods in other cities, and in pagan cities in the land of Israel, he builds temples to the imperial cult, and he also is a patron of the Olympic Games. The Olympic Games are not neutral athletic events. They are dedicated athletic events. So this is a form of pagan piety at one remove. He also, as you might remember, did a major architectural accomplishment in downtown Jerusalem. So this monotheism is messy in antiquity, and Herod is a good example of a messy monotheist. Number four is a terrific inscription, one of my favorites. There is a vivid argument about whether the ethnicity of the inscription is Jewish or non-Jewish. It's impossible to tell which is the point. It's a synagogue inscription. That's what a prayer house is, a prosuche. But the invocation of the inscription begins by talking to the Most High God, the Almighty, the Blessed One, which is a Jewish trope for the Jewish God. But it ends by invoking Zeus, Gaia, and Helios, who are lower gods, local gods who are called to witness. And if you think of the way, I think it's Isaiah 2, calling the witness of heaven and earth. It's that same kind of idea. Exodus 22:27, when it comes into Greek, changes from "do not revile God" to "do not revile the gods," which is a different take-home message. And Philo, who does a commentary on this part of Exodus, mentions that Jews should respect foreign rulers who are, quote, of the same seed as the gods. Again, the family relationship. Finally, of course, number six, Jews are part of the world of the first century gymnasium. We have a list of names of boys in the Ephibate and Cyrene. Two of them are Jesus, son of Antiphilos, and Eleazar, son of Eleazar, on a stele that is dedicated to Hercules and Hermes, who are the gods of the gymnasium. There might be many other Jews on the stele as well, but we just can't tell because they happen not to have Jewish names. But the point is that these young men were getting a good Greek education. And we also know from inscriptions that Jews serve in city government, in athletics, in the theater, and in foreign armies. None of those are religiously neutral activities. All of those involve showing respect to the gods of others. So the complaints of the classical ethnographers notwithstanding, Jews were hardly uninvolved with the gods of their host cities. Classical ethnographers, those of you who have read Benny Zak's big book know this territory, classical ethnographers will complain about Jewish amixia, that Jews don't mix, they don't eat with Gentiles, they don't date Gentiles, they don't marry Gentiles, they don't do anything the way we do. And some people have taken these to be descriptive of ancient Jewish populations. Two things. Classical ethnographers say the same things about all other ethnic groups. In the words of Gidi Bohak, in classical ethnography, even the stereotypes are stereotyped. So what you say about any foreign group is they don't mix. Not mixing is considered a bad thing. But also against this idea of not mixing, there's the enormous production of Hellenistic Jewish literature, which presupposes the penetration into the world of the gymnasium. And that means that is not a God-free environment. So we have a lot of mixing between Jews and non-Jews on the Jewish side, and we have no less mixing of non-Jews and Jews on the pagan side. A list of different ways of saying God-fearer under practical arrangements with the Jewish God. The first item I should have had, but I don't, is temple tourism, a local industry. Jerusalem ran in the black for as long as the temple stood, and it's because people were paying too much for parking, even back then. So there was such a thing as temple tourism in antiquity. You'd sail counterclockwise, you'd go down to Egypt, then you'd come up and you go to Jerusalem, then you'd continue on to Banyas, then you'd go through Asia Minor, and then you'd go home. But you don't, unlike the way we might peer with some interest at the exotic architecture of others, if you go to a temple, you're going into the zone of that god. So it's not a religiously neutral event to be this type of tourist. So there is an enormous Gentile foot traffic, pagan foot traffic, through the temple court. That's one of the reasons why Herod designed the building the way he did. But we also, in the diaspora cities, have interactions between pagan host communities and resident Jewish communities as well. And often Jews are citizens of their own cities. families. We have complaints about this. Juvenal, who is a satirist, which means, again, he's doing caricatures, he's not giving us description. He mentions in Satire 14 that that a father who worships only the sky and takes off one day in every seven, had sons who eventually, and I have converted scare quotes because that's not what Juvenal says, although that's how we might read him. He says the sons eventually spurn their own laws and follow Jewish law, which is the way ancients configure what we talk about as conversion. You desert your own laws, and in that sense, your own ancestors, and you take up foreign laws. The problem with God-fearing, which is this sort of showing respect however you feel like to the Jewish God in whatever way is comfortable for you, the problem with that, says Juvenal, is that it's a slippery slope and it can lead to the problem of desertion. Secondly, voluntary sympathizers, or we've just read the Megillah, so we've just bumped into this word, Judaizers. Judaizers is the voluntary assumption of some Jewish ancestral practices by people who are not themselves Jews. Such voluntary sympathizers were not required to make an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel. Let me use another slightly anachronistic way of framing this. Judaizing is not a halachic issue. It's the ad hoc, improvised, individual assumption of on the part of a non-Jew of some Jewish practices. And that means that there is a very wide variety in this sort of way of outsiders relating to the Jewish God. In the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 10, there's a Roman centurion who I think he builds a synagogue and loves the Jewish people, and Peter and he end up having an important conversation. But the point is that Cornelius, as a military officer, would be involved in Roman cult, obviously, as well. Tertullian, circa 200, complains that some pagans, Gentiles, keep the Sabbath and Passover, but they continue to worship at their traditional altars. Commodian mocks a pagan whom he calls Amadeus Judaeus, who is rushing between the synagogue and traditional altars. Just looking at the Tertullian again, I wonder how the pagans kept Passover. It's an interesting to consider. Right. Well, that's a good point too. Commodian basically scolds the Jews for not trying to convert the pagan, for not trying to get the pagan to stop acting like a pagan. Cyril of Alexandria in the 5th century complains about the same thing. What they are complaining about is that synagogues accommodate pagan interest without the demand of an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel. Also, the Jewish God is invoked by pagan magicians. Why? Because it works, obviously. And not only by Jewish magicians, but Origen says by almost anybody who's competent to deal in magic and spells. We have epigraphical evidence. The Jewish inscription from Aphrodisias, which was originally dated 3rd century, has been redated to the 4th and the 5th century, which means that some of these people who are listed as God-fearers, who are members of the town council, could even be Christian and not pagan. But in any case, they are non-Jews, or they wouldn't be listed as God-fearers. And a list of pagan benefactions to building synagogues culled from Levine's big book on the ancient synagogue. So not only were non-Jews actively involved to some degree or another, discretionarily, in synagogue life, but here's the shocker, when there was a fund drive they were hit for donations. And it's a good thing, because that's why we have these donor plaques where we can reconstruct their activity. Christian Gentiles, like pagan Gentiles, also show up in synagogues, and we have a terrific list of complaints in the work of John Chrysostom, his High Holiday Drashot from 386, complaining about Gentile Christians going to synagogue services, sleeping overnight, incubation, looking for a cure, taking oaths, fasting on Yom Kippur, eating in Sukkot, helping friends build sukkahs, attending seders, and immersing in Jewish mikvahot. And finally, throughout antiquity, and this has, of course, been collected very usefully by Amnon Linda, there are church councils which are constantly forbidding and therefore trying to limit the sort of normal Jewish, non-Jewish interaction around the synagogue. The point here is that God-fearers are voluntary Judaizers. They are practicing and practical pagans. They are not proselutoi, which we often translate as converts. The word proselutoi means somebody who has drawn near. It's proselutoi become Jews of a special sort. They have certain legal disabilities in terms of whom they can marry. It's very hard to know how women would qualify for this. What we hear mostly about is issues involving men, because it involves circumcision. But both Jews and pagans speak of this radical form of affiliation with Jewish ancestral custom as through government language. Philo speaks of non-Jews who join the Jewish politeia. Tacitus complains of people who abandon ancestral cult, disown their gods, country, and family, and so on. So this is the way to imagine this is from pagans who take offense at this sort of thing, it's considered a type of cultural treason, what we would consider conversion. I also want to suggest, and this is why I scream it in capital letters at the top of the third page of the handout, given the ethnic embeddedness of divinity and antiquity, the idea of conversion scarcely makes sense. Not only from the pagan side, but also on the Jewish side. Now, in New Testament studies, there's been a reactivation looking at the Book of Jubilees and arguing that the idea, so it's gone from, within my lifetime, having Jews run missions to Gentiles to having Jews think that what we call conversion is not even possible, because it's a genealogical model that held and not the radical volunteer model that held. There are two pagan analogs to what we think of as conversion: adoption and marriage. Paul will use the, not as a metaphor, because he talks about pagans joining his interpretation of the movement around Jesus of Nazareth as adoption, but marriage also. Both marriage and adoption, adoption was a ceremony presided over by a pontifex as well. This represents a voluntary change of pantheons, liturgically creating a bond of real but fictive kinship, and obligate the incoming party to new ancestors. It used to be that only God or the historians can rewrite the past, but it also turns out that, in a sense, adoption and marriage in antiquity rewrite the past, because you inherit obligations to new ancestors through a liturgical ceremony, new customs, and gods. All this by way of introducing the chidush of this paper, which is that when Paul does his outreach to pagans, he's not thinking in terms of, quote, conversion. He's thinking in terms of the end of days. Paul and his cohort thought of themselves as living at the edge of the end of time. They were expecting the return of the Messiah within their own lifetimes, which would entail a lot of other things. What would it entail? Here's a list, which is a complete hodgepodge. This is sort of my version of a pure type analysis of eschatological expectation, which means there is no single text that has all of these characteristics exactly as I've represented it, but this is a selection of things that we can find from different apocalyptic texts. First, there are bad times, and then there are good times. Destruction of the wicked, resurrection of the dead, return to the land, rebuilding the temple. Pagans bury their idols and turn to the God of Israel. I want to emphasize, and I didn't hear, I should have, there are negative traditions also about what happens to Gentiles at the end of the world. Not nice. And then there are positive traditions as well, both traditions often appearing in the same text. Isaiah will have a number of different things to say about what happens to pagans on the day of the Lord. But in the Massachusetts Democrat version of eschatological expectation, pagans bury their idols and turn to the God of Israel. And there you have, I won't go through the list, but from the way classical prophets are read and from Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha, what these Gentiles will do. They will bury their idols, which you can do because humans are, any human can destroy an idol. No human can destroy a god. In some of these cases, the gods also, these lower powers at the end will turn and worship the God of Israel. And their people do that as well. Does bent knee mean submission or does it mean worship? It's hard to know, but there's a universal acknowledgement of the God of Israel, which will result in peace. This is the nice tradition is what also will flow into later rabbinic ideas about what happens when history moves into a special zone. I don't remember the rabbinic text, but somebody in the room will know. There's a discussion whether in the age to come Israel will receive proselytes. And the answer is, I love that. I mean, as if there's not enough going on now, the argument is, what about later? But the fact that the answer is no, Israel won't receive proselytes, then means that there's an expectation that there are two demographically in the kingdom, there are two different populations, Jews and non-Jews, or else there wouldn't have been that argument. My point is that these pagans do not eschatologically, quote, convert to Judaism, even by the ancient definition of proselytism. These Gentiles do not assume responsibility for Jewish ancestral custom. There is no end of time circumcision party. These Gentiles turn. And the Greek word is epistrepho. I give you some examples there. Paul uses the word as well. This word turning, epistrepho, comes into Latin and then comes into English and then is mistranslated in the notes and in the text of the RSV as convert, which completely obscures the difference between the two ideas. These eschatological Gentiles do not become Jews eschatologically. They turn to the God of Israel, and it is as non-Jews that they show respect to the God of Israel. In Philippians 2, these gods also turn and kneel to the God of Israel. So who is Paul's audience when he is taking this message of a returning Messiah out on the road and doing pagan outreach? He's going to pagans who formerly actively worship traditional gods, and he gives a list of some of their characteristics. on the bottom of page 3. What are his requirements when he talks to this audience? He has two. He says that his pagans must abstain from sins, especially idol worship and fornication, which is, porneia is something that perennially accompanies Jewish discussions of idol worship, and after item A at the top of page 4, you'll see all the places where he talks about it. So that is the first qualification, no gods, no other gods other than the God of Israel. He'll tell his Corinthian community, look, we all know there are many gods and many lords, but for us, there's one God, namely my God, Paul's God, and one Lord, his son Jesus. So he's putting that out front. But his second requirement is that his pagans must not receive circumcision. They must not receive circumcision. They have to remain ethne. So on the one hand, he's saying you have to worship only the Jewish God, but you may not do so as Jews. It's important to Paul that these ethne remain ethne, which is exactly where the argument about circumcision comes out. In other words, like God-fearers, Paul's ethne retain their native ethnicities. Unlike God-fearers, they make an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel. Like proselutoi, they make an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel. Unlike proselutai, they do not assume Jewish ancestral practices such as food, Shabbat, and especially in Paul's letters, circumcision. It's a little bit muddied because basically Paul is shoving idealized Jewish ethics down the throats of his pagans. He's telling them no idols, only the God of Israel, and then he will actually give a list of the commandments on the second table of the law, in terms of, it's the Ten Commandments, it's nine of the Ten Commandments. That's not bad. In terms of this sort of Judaizing that he is invoking as what should be their standard of behavior, but he's insisting at the same time that they don't, quote unquote, become Jews. Who are these people? They are not converts. I can't tell you how many times I've gone into print calling them converts. I'm so embarrassed. They're not converts. Exactly the point is that they're not converts. They have to remain ethne. They're eschatological pagans. We could call them ex-pagan pagans. Originally, they had had only a literary life in Jewish restoration theology. They were an apocalyptic hope and an apocalyptic trope. And in the first generation of the Jesus movement, we see them becoming a confused and confusing social category, which is one of the cool things about doing history. But that doesn't mean that they are converts. What does Paul call them? He calls them hagioi, separate ones, separated ones. His hagioi, holy ones, are different from the ethne who do not know God, because his hagioi do know God. He calls them ethne. Now I am talking to you, ethne. And the word that is very important is that he calls them adelphoi, brothers. He doesn't call them brothers and sisters, despite the way the text is now translated. This last term means that they are ethne. I think they are fleshly descendants of Abraham, although he'll use Abraham in different ways in the letters. But he says that they are, here comes the Roman idea, they are adopted. Adelphoi, adopted brothers. They, like Jews, after their adoption, get to call God Abba, Father. Katapneuma, once they are brought into the movement, according to the Spirit, they are brothers. They are brothers who are made, not born. But catasarca, according to the flesh, they remain distinct, which is the case with all human adoption. And if they are sons, then they are heirs. Good Roman basis for becoming inheriting the promises to Abraham. In other words, and this is where I'll stop, Jewish apocalyptic thought severed antiquity's normal and normative correspondence of ethnicity and cult. But in the early Christian iteration of this tradition, through his idea of adoption, Paul also restores this idea. If pagans now worship Israel's God, then they were pneumatically brought into that God's family. And this is because, to end where I began, which is what we're rhetorically trained to do, in antiquity, gods and humans form family groups. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And of course, we will be open for discussion. Quite a long time.
Gregory Tatum from the COVID League. Paula, this is, the argument is cogent. All of your major points are convincing. But to quibble.
But, oh, I knew it was coming. All right.
In Romans 9:4, you translate huiothesia as sonship, but then at the end you translate it as adoption.
Yes.
So there's you're rhetorically translating it one place one way and another place another.
I think it would be adoption in both cases, actually. And I think that's because of the peculiarity of the Jewish God, mm-hmm. who doesn't actually have sons catasarca the way all his colleagues do in the foreign pantheons. What do you think of that? Does that make sense to you?
I think that makes sense to me.
Okay.
What I would also say is that I think we also have to problematize the category somewhat, because adoption and sonship are very close in Paul's thought because of the role of the Spirit, mm-hmm. Naaman. Mm-hmm. So because they have received the Spirit of God and the Spirit of Christ, they can cry out, Abba, Father. But that's because they have been pneumatically united with the Son. Mm-hmm. And therefore, they're Jews because Jesus was a Jew.
Are they Jews?
Not in the this worldly sense. Yeah, according to the flesh, they're not.
Right.
According to the flesh, they're not.
Right.
But according to the Spirit,
they're he thinks that the Roman community has the Spirit and that they're sons, and yet he says, "I'm speaking to you, ethne."
That's right. That's right. And so it's. That's what I meant by problematize. I think that there's a lot of murky sort of things here that I think are not as...
I think one of the problems, first of all, what he's dealing with is an unprecedented historical situation. Time is going to end in his generation. And I think instead of murky, maybe radioactive would be, is a category that really has no place in normal circumstances. That because of this surprising way God's done things of a Messiah who's come once but is about to come back again, he's dealing in this special wrinkle in time between the first and second coming. So this, he's...
traditional language breaks down.
He has this traditional category of end time Gentiles to draw on, but on the map of the Greco-Roman city, they don't fit. Nor do they fit on the map of the Greco-Roman diaspora synagogue. I mean, it's really awkward to have these people involved with the synagogue as well, which I think is one of the reasons they were probably expelled from synagogues, as well as being considered a security risk for the ancient city. Please.
I have two questions. First of all, thank you. That was an eye-opener. But my first question is, okay, so when does conversion become conversion? Mm-hmm. Okay, in other words, so going to the end of your... So when does conversion to Christianity become conversion to, from something to another religion? And my second question, it goes back to the beginning, and it seems to me that in the way you presented it, but I might have misunderstood, you actually think, you actually posit the Jews as a religion, even though you're trying to say is that the Jews aren't, the Jews also shouldn't be thought of or classified as a religious entity, because it always seems to be the pagans against the Jews, and the Jews are almost a classification of a religious entity.
I think Jews is an ethnic group, and ethnic groups travel with their gods.
So you're thinking of Jews also not as a religious entity, but as an ethnic group who
therefore have their own ancestral connections with divinity and their own ethnic god, the god of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, a god who is everywhere but particularly in Jerusalem, a god who, through various epiphanies, gave the rules for the correct protocols to show him respect, and a god who other people can also be interested in showing respect to, and that should be encouraged.
So would you translate Judeos as Jews or as people from Judah who have that ethnic, who are that of that ethnic?
What a fight that is right now. Is it the Judean antiquities or the Jewish antiquities? The problem with calling Judaioi Judeans, even though that's good because it has that territorial aspect to it, is you end up by saying things like Philo, a first century Judean, but he wasn't. He was living in Egypt.
Right, and he took his Judean ethnos with him to the Alexandrian, who also worshipped the Jew who was...
the naughty Jew.
Right.
Tiberius Julius Alexander, right. Mm-hmm. It's confusing to call diaspora Jews Judeans.
But if you call them Jews, then we're muddling the waters, no?
It's an unhappy choice. But Judean, the word Judean is so local. Like I can live with calling, it's even confusing. Does that make Jesus Judean, given how prominent the Galilean traditions are? And if he's not Judean, what do you call him? But
He's a provincial one.
Yeah.
Provincial.
From Galilee.
A provincial Judean.
Lives in the suburbs.
He's provincial.
There's not a happy solution precisely because,
because they're both
correct.
Because the argument you're trying to bring forward, which I like very much, is that if you then use the word Jew, mm-hmm. right, then that confuses the... because then you start thinking in categories of religion.
Right, because Jew is still a designator in our own period, and it functions, although Jew, unlike Catholic, for example, has an ethnic, more of an ethnic-ness to it. It's a messy term, and I think it's precisely because it comes in this period where gods and ethnicity are bonded.
What about Greek, the name Greeks? Does a Greek who lives in, I don't know, in the land of Israel or in Ephesus, it's the same
if as they're,
the word right. Greeks.
Well, again, Greek is a little bit like Africa. I mean, a Lydian would think of themselves as different from an Athenian, would think of themselves as different from a Spartan, and all those different genē would have gods that are particular to those particular people, all of whom would be under the umbrella of to Hellenikon, Greekness. But the vocabulary itself is a problem. To not duck this question, but say you to your second one, because it's related, I think. When does conversion become conversion? Is what kind of term is conversion? Is it an emic term or not? If it's not, can we use it? Well, I think we can use whatever analytical vocabulary we find useful. I mean, I'm happy as an economic historian to talk about inflation in the 3rd century without getting anxious about anachronism. But I think that when you use the word convert, it's not appropriate to Paul, because he, I know it's hard to imagine a Jew who'd be like this, but he thinks that everybody, other Jews who don't agree with him, are wrong, and he's right, and he has the correct interpretation of Judaism. And he's not, and he's telling his pagan audience precisely not to become Jews. So it's, so conversion doesn't work. The word conversion, even though I still think with it.
But does it work for Peter at that time?
Why would it?
Or his other missionaries that go to the Galatians and said, oh, you have to circumcise to become a Christian. Is conversion there? Is it the conversion?
Well, that's why, for the people who were actually living it, that's why they use the word proselutoi, and what they don't say you have to. What they say is you have to, you assume a different set of laws. They're conceptualizing it in terms of confederation. They're not conceptualizing it in terms of what we think of as religion, because ancestral custom is what you eat, who you marry, what you worship, how you do it. You know, it's a whole collection of stuff, not just exclusively the piece that has to do with relating heaven and earth.
That's lots of people.
Thank you, Paula. My question pertains to the former discussion about Jews and Judeans, mm-hmm. Bringing in the name Israel, mm-hmm. And because Paul uses it a lot, and especially in this famous sentence, not everybody who is from Israel is an Israeli. Mm-hmm. Israeli. So how does it fit?
He uses the word Hebrews, he uses the word Israelites, he uses the word Jew. Has everybody here has seen Life of Brian, right? He's a Hebe, a hook nose, a Red Sea pedestrian. He uses all those terms, and depending on what he needs his particular argument to go, he'll shape it. He'll shape it that way. He talks about being particularly zealous for the traditions of the paradosis patricon, ton patricon, for the ancestral traditions.
Yes, but if it's an ethnic definition, how can someone of Israel not be an Israeli?
Oh, well, that's because he's doing a very fancy dance about who's in and who's out when he's starting in Romans 9, where he starts that argument. By the time he gets to the end of the argument in Romans 11, he's talking about all the 70 nations plus all Israel, who, what's going to happen, they're all going to realize that Paul is right about the identity of the Messiah. And then in Romans 15, when he ends the letter, he has a cento of quotations where things like, rejoice, O ethne, with his laos, rejoice, Gentiles, with his people, where he's actually saying that these two groups are two groups, it's Israel and everybody else, are all going to be joined together eschatologically. So, I don't see a happy solution to the Judean versus Jewish translation, which is precisely the strength of the issue of how much these two ideas are associated in antiquity. Hi.
I'm very much
Augustine's different.
No, I'm very much convinced by every detail you brought, and I'm less sure about the conclusions.
Okay.
And I think that, as you said before, in relation with the notion of conversion, the problem might be much more analytical. So, actually, there are a series of notions which I ask myself if we can interpret differently. First of all, what is exactly antiquity here? You mentioned your dissertation about religion in late antiquity. I'm not sure when you come to a conclusion if what you say about Paul and the very first generation of the Jesus cult is mm-hmm. true for 2nd century or 3rd century.
Mm-hmm.
And there the question of Chaim is of more relevance. So then what is exactly, what do you mean by conversion? Mm-hmm. I mean, in the 2 chapter of William James' psychological analysis of conversion, there is, I think, one case of conversion from one religion to other, which mm-hmm. is a Jew mm-hmm. that became Christian, but otherwise he's speaking about what we will call in Hebrew tshuva. He's speaking mm-hmm. about kind of
renewal or
inner turn of the self, of reinvention of the self, and many other things, which seems to be very popular. There are many volumes dedicated to this new self of late antiquity and transformation of the self, and then Apuleius in his Metamorphosis seems to be suggesting a very rich literary description of all kind of such turning points from one cult to another, from with this invention and celebration of the self. And then perhaps again the term might be very relevant even anachronistically.
Mm-hmm.
So something happened to Paul mm-hmm. on his way to Damascus. It was kind of inner turn and whatever,
right.
If or if not.
But that's where we're using it as an I always confuse these ethic term. I mean, right, we're saying that even though there isn't a separate religion for Paul to convert to, it's like somebody who is Lahavdil Naturi Karta becoming by a Yehudi or something. It's with all within Judaism, but it's still a radical change of heart. I was thinking when you mentioned James of A.D. Nock, who's the other go-to classic, right, for this type of thing, a turning from something to something else that implies that the former was wrong. And the decision is right. If we want to use the term conversion for any radical change, and it doesn't even have to be between religions, then we're using the term outside of an historical context.
In
I think
religious sociology, it will be a reaffirmation not only of the self, but a reaffirmation of communities' belief. So we know it in medieval Christianity. We have it all the time.
Mm.
This kind of reaffirmation of communities' belief through this advances.
So conversion as reaffirmation, intensification, maybe some.
Yeah.
Internal transformation.
That yeah. Our database.
And then to the local aspects, it reminds me a little bit of the present discussion of globalization or glocalization. So again, if you are speaking about imperial time, mm-hmm. quote Augustus and the others, we do have many mechanisms that are blurring and enabling the first of all, even in classic Greek, I mean, when we see the wandering gods, the way Artemis or Dionysius
travel yeah.
and the real mechanisms of wandering deities, but in the imperial cult, and especially with the new ones of Isis and the others, so we do have. We always have these local entities, but we have also other very powerful global mechanisms. And it seems that the language of Paul gets very nice into this kind of mechanism. And here comes my last point, which is maybe we have, in a very traditional manner, to pay more respect to this pneumatic language,
mm-hmm.
which means it's not only dismissing circumcision and the other, and Shabbat and the others, mm-hmm. transforming them into a very different spiritual level, mm-hmm. in which they not only still exist, but become the reveals the true meaning. So we can always. I mean, it's a metaphor. It's the metaphorical level that we can take more seriously?
Well, I think that first of all, we can use words however we decide to. And certainly for the business of this seminar, you can decide what conversion means and apply it. I'm just... I think the case here with, do we call God-fearers also converts? I mean, there's this voluntary Judaizing. They do some, but not all. But let's face it, born Jews are doing some, but not all, too. So well, what are we talking about?
It's like a third order.
Yeah. I don't know. Did this, because spirit was just invoked, did this play off of what you wanted to say? Because you mentioned
I think it's different. I think what I wanted to emphasize was that we're not dealing with the God of the Enlightenment, who is a universal God of reason. We're dealing with the God of Israel. And Christians are worshiping the God of Israel and not somebody else's universal God. They're not worshiping Zeus or Amun-Ra or whomever. And so their relation to him is also an ethnic one, insofar as they have been united spiritually with Jesus. But we also have to remember that pneuma has to be understood in Greek culture and in Greek medicine and in Greek philosophy as a very embodied reality. The pneuma is that sort of gaseous liquid that gets in the body and inhabits you, and that you you are physiologically transformed by it.
Right.
So I think that, and there are levels of the spirit, and there are different kinds of spirit. The Holy Spirit can come in by, it can be the spirit of the world, or it could be the spirit of cosmic sin and death, or it can be the spirit of the stoicheia, or it could be the Holy Spirit. And so there are different kinds of spirits, too. So I think that's fundamentally different, because the cases you were talking about, like ISIS and other ones, you've got, they're not giving up their own gods. They're worshiping Aphrodite and whomever else. And
so it's this idea of exclusive commitment that makes this a weird...
It's that, well, exclusive latreia. Mm-hmm. It's exclusive cult that is the weird, really... monolatry is a sign of Judaism and Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
That's the unusual thing, as you were pointing out.
Yeah.
Also, I really like...
Well, it's just for the non-local cult, not for the...
Right. But for Christians, you'd be considered a bad Christian if you were still worshiping the other folks. One little footnote on our old pal, Moschus Judaios, is he's quoting by Zeus, Gaia, and Helios. What's interesting there is...
Oh, that's Pathos.
Oh, that's Pathos.
Lahavdil, not... okay. Right.
But the thing is that Gaia and Helios don't get a lot of cult, but they're really common in oath form.
Oh.
So it's kind of interesting that they're oath formula gods rather than gods who get a lot of individual cult.
Thank you.
Okay, I have two questions. The first is regarding conversion. As you rightly said, it's a definition of hell. And of course, it is not the same as what Jews meant as cure. Okay, conversion to Judaism, accepting all the commandments and so on, which is a different thing. The question is, what conversion could mean in the ancient world? If it was turning from one thing to another thing, I don't know. I mean, it's really a problem of English and Greek and so on. So let's leave it aside. But what I really want to ask is whose own conception of, in fact, abolishing the specific traits of Judaism and accepting into his, whatever you want to call it, if you don't want to call it religion, then whatever, eschatological vision, idea, whatever, but he means to accept everyone. He says there is no Jew, there is no Greek, there is no gentleman, no Gentile, and so on. So how this goes into the ethnic concept, how this goes about the state.
He says that in Galatians 3:28. It's that's not a statement of social policy. If you look at 1 Corinthians, ladies have to keep their
their head covered when they're in service. He gives communities should support apostles, just like the law says. Keeping the law is one of the benefits you get from being infused with the correct type of spirit. Neither circumcision nor uncircumcision matters. Everybody should stay in the state in which he is called. So it's not like he's certainly not egalitarian, or he's certainly, I mean, one of his letters is about the return of a runaway slave. I mean, he's, the people are, everyone is one pneumatically.
Yeah, I didn't mean socially before.
Yeah, but they're not, he's not creating a new entity, and I don't think he's abolishing Judaism.
He says that circumcision doesn't matter.
But he's speaking to Gentiles. He's speaking to Gentiles. All of his letters are addressed to Gentiles. I think even Rabbi Akiva would agree with him that circumcision doesn't matter for Gentiles. He's all of his letters are addressed to pagan audiences. He's
The question is if he intended to include them or to just...
He's including them. He's saying the ness is that they can be included now at this particular moment because of this dying and rising with Christ and getting infused with the Spirit in the baptism and hold on and act the right way because Christ is about to come back and then we'll all be transformed and the dead will be raised and all this other stuff. So he's speaking in a very immediate, very concrete time frame. But he's not abolishing Judaism. I mean, remember, what he always ends his letters, I should never say always because there's bound to be an exception. Most of the time he ends his letters sounding like a UJA official. He's doing a collection to send back to Jerusalem, and he's going back. And the terms he uses for when he is trying to articulate how his pagans are being integrated, he uses temple language. The idea of their being sanctified, right? Their idea of their being, it's all these temple protocols. He says that he is sacrificing them. He's the Kohen to Christ. He's the Levite to Christ Kohen to, and they're sacrificing the offering of the Gentiles. So he's very much functioning within a Jewish paradigm. It just happens to be this radioactive apocalyptic paradigm. I was watching what was going to happen with Lubavitch with great interest, and it kind of died down, but there was something going on there for a little bit too. Yes.
No, no. But doing that, he's creating a new community.
Yes,
a
but
community who is not ethnically based, but is spiritually based. He creates a new sense of peoplehood. And how can you turn it? You can turn it to return to the concept of conversion. If by that we mean a radical change. What could be more radical than to create a new community of people, of men, who are some who are coming from Judaism, other from Gentility, but what they have in common that they are a common belief in the Messiah, in Christ the Messiah.
Yeah, I would, first of all, I would problematize the translation of pistis as belief. I mean, again, we can't help but stand where we are to this side of the Protestant Reformation, right? And belief means certain things, but I would want to think more of conviction, steadfastness, and Noah tells Jews to stop living Jewishly. He's telling Gentiles not to assume Jewish ancestral practices except for the ones that he is telling them to assume. So he's so is it a new community? We don't even know the social location of these pagans. For all we know, given that the Abraham, the law, David, Mashiach, kingdom of God, all those things must have made sense to them somehow. The only place where that would make sense is if they had heard it in the synagogue.
we don't know if these people are still going to the synagogue or not. If they were once God-fearers, why all of a sudden, if the only place in town to hear the Bible read out loud in Greek is in the ethnic reading house of the Jews, which is one way of translating prosyche, we don't know if these people are going to synagogues or not. So it's, I mean, the idea, in the retrospective history, we know that this is going to be a new community. In terms of your question, you know, what period of time am I talking about? I'm talking a Wednesday sometime in the year 50, because I'm trying to get into Paul's head and looking at what he thinks he's doing. And I think given the foreshortened time frame he's working in, he doesn't think of himself as establishing a new community. This will become a new community. I think by the second century, I'm happy.
With Justin Martyr.
Yeah, I mean, I think in the second century, when you have these intra-Jewish arguments floating into intra-Gentile context by the second century, I think conversion is, in the sense of different religions, different ethnicities, I'm happy with that. But what's wonderful about looking at Paul and what causes the mental cramps that it does is precisely because he's in this very, very particular position.
But if then to continue there,
with Claude,
and Claude, and then with Ishai Rosenzvi and Adi Ophir, you can say that what he's doing, Paul, in his mission to the Gentiles, is to creating the non-Jewish category, which is by emphasizing so much on the difference, as you say, is creating a new ethnos, which is all the non-Jews.
He's
blaring.
You mean as a third ethnos?
No, the second. There is actually the whole cosmos. Oh, okay, so because what we have now is.
Because these are Gene with a difference, right?
Jews, non-Jews who are Christians, mm-hmm. and the ethne who are not there yet. Mm-hmm. But all those Christians, all those communities are now becoming one ethnos, which is the non-Jews, which is this the category of the Goy, of the Gentile. Mm-hmm. And within this imperial theological, political concept, is if we take seriously the charges against the Jews, which and not to, perhaps, that they were throughout the empire actually questioning this ethnic division by not paying respect, by not showing respect to the local god.
But they did show respect
to
local gods.
Brought also this charge,
the naughty Jews,
them.
Okay.
Then he's Judaizing.
He's Judaizing the ethnic.
The rest of the empire.
Yeah.
Which actually,
it's a type of Jewish outreach.
It's
a type of, he's doing a type of Jewish outreach, but he's saying precisely they mustn't become Jews. And the thing, I mean, when he, but they become they're proto-Jews. That's why it's so interesting in Romans when he addresses, he says specifically, now I'm speaking to you Goyim.
Yeah.
Right? He has no, he himself, the word Christian hasn't been invented yet. He has no category for these people.
But he creates this category.
But he creates.
Well, his interpreters create the category.
He's you know, Paul, we can overlook this fact because the only letters we have are from him. He's not the only Jewish apostle within this movement who's also going to Gentiles, telling them they don't have to be circumcised. He's to the community at Rome. He's writing ahead to a place he hasn't been yet. And they're the same type of ethne as the ones he left behind in Corinth. So it's not only Paul who's coming up with this category, which means that we don't want to look into Paul's psyche in his moment of conversion and figure out what was unique to him and then explain what he's doing, because there are other Jews who are doing the same thing he's doing for the same reason. So therefore, they have to be drawing on something, which is why I pulled out the on page three these themes from the nation's turning. So nations who turn at the end of time is a Jewish category. They're still called ethne, which is why Paul cites those verses in Romans 15. The root of Yishai will rise, him who rises to rule the ethne, in him will the ethne rejoice. He's very specific that these people in Christ have to remain ethne, or else he wouldn't have a biblical template to frame them with.
Plenty of questions still.
Sure.
Thanks again, Paula. In some sense, it's too good of a solution. That's my methodological question. All of us who grappled with Paul and with deciphering this impossible, or the how many solutions he tries to bring in order to define the Gentiles' status, right? In each of the texts, I mean, there's no. I don't want to talk about any system of thought that he's. He's just a very unique thinker. And he brings in many ideas in creating this new thing. So I wonder, and we won't sit now and read each chapter in Romans or Galatians or Corinthians for that matter, but just on the more fundamental level, just how much, I mean, how much does it really help us? I'll put it simply. How much does it really help us giving these wide strokes, describing what religion and ethnicities are in antiquity, when we come to talk about this specific Pauline thought? Because all the questions, and I really identify specifically with the question about the community, I do think he's creating a new community, the weak and the strong. We don't know where they're coming from, but he's something trying to build something new. He thinks that the communal level is an alternative, maybe, for the more general Israelite level. But whatever he's doing, I wonder how much it really helps us. Right, very smoothly integrating him within contemporary thought, and the other side of the same coin is thinking it's hard to say otherwise. Clearly Paul is thinking eschatologically, in some sense, he's not using that enough, because that would be a very easy solution. If you have all these goyim, nilvim, coming together, joining, we have that, Isaiah has that, this Zechariah has that. Mm-hmm. These are solutions that we have. They're very deeply embedded in the biblical text. Mm-hmm. But Paul is not using them enough. I'm not saying that it's not there, but he's grappling with other solutions, because the problem is more than that.
Right, I couldn't help but remember the Lily Tomlin routine when if love is the answer, would you please repeat the question? I don't know how much this helps. I do think that in terms of Chaim, if you ask me, okay, if we can't use the paradigm of conversion, what can we use for Paul? I think it's useful to focus on Adelphoi. And where if you worship a god, you have to become part of that god's family. And that's what's being accomplished through the Pneuma. And that's what is enabling these guys, even though they weren't born Yudaioi, they are Adelphoi by adoption, and therefore they can call my god Abba. And that's why, I mean, putting it against the wallpaper of first century Mediterranean antiquity, that's why I wanted to emphasize this idea of literally blood groups between heaven and earth. And so Paul's pagans are anomalous in their social map. We know that he's creating something that will become a new community. He thinks that he is the thin edge of the eschat. His proof that he knows what time it is on God's clock
is precisely the existence of these Gentiles whom Isaiah talked about. This is exactly what's supposed to happen at the end of time before the nations do their eschatological pilgrimage. So how much does it help? Here's what it helps me with. He joins this movement sometime around the year 33, 34. Nobody knows, so it's okay if I don't. We get his letters between the from between the years 50 and 60. He's been running around telling people that the world is about to end for 25 years. The last letter we have from him, he says, I know that salvation is closer to us than when we first were convinced. How, after 25 years of expecting the imminent end of the world, can he still think he's right? Other than the fact that that's who he is. I mean, Paul's never wrong. How can he still think he's right? Because he's getting reinforced precisely by this traditional Jewish idea that at the end of time, the nations will not become Jews. The nations will turn and worship Israel's God. And, you know, I have a choice of thinking either that he's, you know, just delusional. It would get on my nerves to think that the world was about to end. I mean, time drags when you expect it to end. And he's more convinced than ever. And so I think trying to place his pagans on this prophetic map that comes out of, as you just said, these different scriptural passages, explains to me how he can say what he says about his own convictions. And that's what, which is a modest, it's a modest thing to be helped with. But what I'm interested in is trying to get into Paul's head, and that's what it helps me with.
If I could just return the discussion to the Bible, this idea of ethnicity in the Bible. I see the rabbinic God as a Jewish male. I don't see the biblical God as an Israelite male. I think that even with these adoption things, you're my son, whatever, there's no, he doesn't act like an Israelite is the way that the rabbinic God acts as like a Jew. But
what about keeping the Sabbath? The Israelite God keeps the Sabbath, right?
Israelites keep the Sabbath.
No, the Israelite God keeps the Sabbath.
They keep it because he keeps it.
Right. So, but isn't that...
But that's not ethnic. That's not
the Sabbath isn't an ethnic custom? Who else is doing it?
But it's a,
other than the ethnic God and his people.
Not convinced, but that's not what I really want to talk about.
Okay.
I want to talk about Esther.
Hey, it's the creation of the weekend. I mean, that was a good idea. Esther, okay.
Mordecai is described just as you have someone here. Named Apollos, that he's a Judaist and he's also an Alexandrian.
Mm-hmm.
But Mordecai is a Yehudi and he's also a Benjaminite.
Mm-hmm.
And then when it's Mitzyahadim, when the, I don't think it means they were Judaizers, I think they were pretending to be Jews so as not to be attacked. And if you look at the story of the Prime Minister of Ontario for Purim this year, sent his message was that the message of Purim is the importance of multiculturalism.
Oops.
But if you look at the book, there is multiculturalism. Every nation gets their language, gets the communications according to their language, according to their customs, whatever. The only thing the Jews didn't do right is that they don't observe the dot of the melech. All right?
Mm-hmm.
That their dot is different than the king's dot. So whether that means religion in our own terms or not, it seems to mean that one could be a Benjaminite observing the religion of the Jews, and other people try to pretend they're Jews, whatever. But there's already some sort of religious, that it's more than just an ethnic thing going on. Because if the problem was just ethnic, then Haman wouldn't have had a case to make. And one further thing, I don't think you're right about Chabad. I think there's still
interesting things going on. Okay, I'm not in that loop.
I don't, the way when people in antiquity talk about what we identify as religion, the terms they use mean ethnic custom or ancestral custom. That's all. It means the idea is that what we think of religion is inherited, and it literally runs in the blood, which is why when you get these imagined dialogues between Christian martyrs and who are Roman and the Roman governor says, look, you can do what you want you can do what you want in the privacy of your own house, but why are you forsaking the mos Romanorum? I mean, it's be both at the same time. So it's this idea of the continuity of the family. It's showing, this is Mediterranean stuff. It's about showing respect to the family and being seen to show respect. And that's how what we think of religion, I think, is. And this idea of showing respect, of course, fits in with the Megillah as well.
So is Mordechai a Judean or is he a Jew?
He's a Judean.
I don't think that's a problem with the categorization. The Jew doesn't exist in your argument.
Yeah, well, it, yeah, right.
Sorry?
Yeah.
Well, it can't exist, because if Jew exists, then the argument falls down.
It's, well, Jew, you know, that's our problem with our vocabulary. We don't have the flexible vocabulary to translate it adequately. So we can make a choice. If we choose to translate it as Judeans, there's a price. And if we choose to translate
Hebrews.
It as Jew, there's another price.
Hebrew.
Don't have this problem in Hebrew because Yehudi is from Yehudan. You don't. The problem comes in when you translate.
No, but you do. If you think about Yehudi, if you think about Yehudi in the Bible as the category of Jew, then you.
Why do I have to think it?
But a lot of people do.
You know, would a family who'd been living for 300 years in Alexandria think of themselves as Judeans?
If they follow the ethnos?
Philo is specifically not a good example, but Philo himself uses a colonialist theory. So he says, I am a Judean who has,
of the paraikos, right.
World. So that, it works. For Philo, right. It works. I don't know if Paul thought the same way.
Well, you know, there's...
Philo, a few years earlier, it worked.
There's a, if you like this kind of thing, there's this wonderful document that describes a forced conversion of 540 Jews on the island of Majorca Minorca, and
418.
418.
418.
And one of the people who are formerly known as Jews, no, one of the Jews, says is, whoever doesn't abandon his patria, meaning Menorca, will have to abandon his fides patrum, the ancestral custom. So this is something that's deep in the diaspora, five centuries into, you know, four centuries past Paul's period, and yet those configurations still hold. I think I was forthright about hoping to confuse people when I started. I hope I haven't missed that mark. It's confusing.
It's interesting.
In Corinthians 1, chapter 7, Paul says that basically believers and unbelievers not necessarily need to divorce.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding was that those believers to whom he was referring were new believers, people who joined the ranks. And, well, so it is the understanding of an late 8th century Christian cleric somewhere in the East. But if this is the case, then what sort of process did these believers go in order to become such?
To become believers?
Yeah.
I assume they're baptized? Is that what you're meaning?
Well, is it
meaning? To what?
To become a believer.
No, conversion to what? What are they converting
from
to?
Pagan
community, into the sect. if Wayne Meeks would talk about sectarian mindset of Paul, would you call that conversion? What was the process that was going on there?
They had to, the Corinthians were a problem. Paul writes back, he finds out that there's a Corinthian who's still worshiping idols, probably because he started out life as a God-fearer and was confused about what the big deal was. He's been showing respect to the Judean God, and now all of a sudden Paul is telling him he can't continue to show respect to his own gods as well, and he's confused about that. That's 1 Corinthians 5. They're joining, is it a subset of the synagogue? I don't know. Are these people, another way to look at them is God-fearers with a difference? Or
what defines them as believers now? What makes them believers as opposed to their previous state?
They have made an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel. Does that make them converts to Judaism?
Well, first of all, do we know that for a fact?
That's the God there.
That's the move that they make.
That's what Paul. All I know is what Paul is telling them they should do, and what Paul tells them they should do is First Corinthians. We all know there are many gods, but for us, there is only one God, right? And that's Paul's God, who's Judean.
So these believers have now dedicated themselves to the Jewish God, living in the same house with non-believers. They pretty much, in terms of the religious phenomenon that occurred, pretty much stayed on the same side of the fence, right?
They're still embedded in their regular social life. What option did they have?
But there was no real transformation there.
I don't understand what you're
from
asking
one
for.
One state to another.
To a state?
Yeah, a state of non-belief in the Jewish God to the state of...
That's why I think belief is a very confusing word to use for this period. It's allegiance and showing respect. They were probably God-fearers, which meant they showed respect, but not exclusive allegiance to the Judean God before Paul came to town. Then once he came to town and said what he said, probably within the synagogue, they had enough of a biblical education to understand what he was talking about when he talked about things like Messiah and the categories of sin. I mean, who's going to be worried about porneia and idol worship unless you have some biblical literacy? And when he's talking about that, they then make a more extreme commitment to the Judean God than they were when they were just coming in as practicing pagans. Is that transformative? Well, in chapter 7, the one you relate, I think what's more transformative is he's basically telling them to stop having sex.
Yes, as a means of distinguishing between.
Right. Well, he says for prayer, and because the form of the world is passing away, and because in view of the impending distress, the world is going to end so soon that you should basically concentrate on prayer, and it's better that you not have sex, and if you do have sex, if that's what you're going to do.
Isn't that another means of creating a boundary there between...
Certainly between husband and wife. That's why he talks about it so much.
But also in a... Sorry for the anachronism, but in a religious sense.
I don't understand.
In the sense that there is a believer and a non-believer on the same roof, and there's an interest in creating drawing a line between the two.
No, he's quite the contrary. He's saying in that case, he's saying you should not divorce the unbelieving spouse. He's saying that you should continue in your marriage to the unbelieving spouse, because the unbelieving spouse of whichever gender is sanctified by the believing spouse. And again, going back to Greg's description, I mean, it's not sanctified, just sounds like a vague holy term. You have pneuma in you, and through this physical contact of sex, the pneuma might also
migrate.
Yeah. That's what he's talking. That's transformative.
you know, between the category of God-fearer and the category of proselutos, and then Paul's coming up with a new thing and a third thing, which he isn't bothering to think of as anchoring as a socially stable entity because he isn't expecting a longue durée. I don't know how to categorize these people except retrospectively as converts. But if I want to, the trouble with retrospect is that it, I mean, I'm speaking now to you historians. The problem with retrospect is that it pulls the historical agents out of their historical context into ours. I know these people were converts to Christianity. Paul didn't know that, and neither did they. So, I mean, part of this is almost an aesthetic issue. How do we speak unanachronistically if we're talking about the past while still using analytical categories? Nadia.
Yes, I would like to argue against the end of days concept. I'm not contesting the fact that Paul spoke about the end of days. And it is a theme that runs in the Bible, runs in the New Testament, runs also in later writings, Christian and Jewish writings. It doesn't mean that the end of days is imminent, but it is not necessarily imminent. And that is a concept that runs throughout the period of the Middle Ages. I don't know, take a thinker like Joachim of York, which I know better, mm-hmm. you know, the area he lived in and worked in. He was also very much convinced that the end of days is imminent, is coming the next day, and yet he preached for quite a long time. He had disciples who preached more or less the same thing without the end of days happening. And still, he had to answer all sorts of questions.
Did he have to explain why it was taking so long?
No, he didn't. And I don't think Paul had any reason to try to explain why it wasn't happening. He expected it. He wanted to prepare for it, but he was not necessarily sure that it would happen in his own day.
Yes, he says, these words were written for us upon whom the end of the ages has come.
I'm not contesting the verbiage, I'm not contesting the words he used or anything, but this concept runs around. It's something that
Listen, I spend part of my day living in America. People who vote, most of them are in Texas, think that the end of days is upon us with every presidential. So, I mean, I understand. I think that he is dealing with a social phenomenon that convinces him that he really is at the edge of the end of time, and that is precisely these weird ethne who are enabled, because what does it mean that they have spirit? They prophesy, they have visions, they can discern between different spirits. They have all these charismata that they can do, and that's exactly what he's expecting. And also in Romans 9-11, he comes up with an explanation for why it's taken until the mid-first century, not that anybody's dating Anno Domini, but he's explaining why it's still taking so long.
Yes, but as you said, this thing happens all along. I don't know, I talked about Joachim of Fiore, and I can talk about Abraham Abulaf, I can talk about lots of thinkers.
Right.
So that the end of days is imminent, and it comes the next day or in their own lifetime and so on. And mm-hmm. yet they did also other things, and they preached for different lifestyles and to change things.
So connecting that with Paul, what do you want to say? I mean, if we put Paul against the Joachim of Fiore wallpaper.
In the end of days.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, but he created the community for the end of
for
days.
For the end of days, yes.
Yeah, well, not even for the end of days, he created it for the what he believed was the third status. Right?
Conclusions
the third,
for Christianity of the second millennium to the very first generation.
Which is not a Christianity.
Whatever it is, but post-Augustine in the Catholic Western sense, it's totally different world.
I hadn't thought of Paul as a first century Texan. Maybe I have to.
Protestant too.
Right.
I was wondering, how do you, I mean, Paul seems to use the motif of dying to the self, dying, this is what we know, I mean, as legal mm-hmm. historians, is maybe the most important motif for conversion afterwards mm-hmm. that becomes the description of one dies to his own self and born into the new religion.
Is it reborn as a new, right?
Yes, and it goes back, of course, to the gospel and to the crucifixion of Christ and dying for the sin and dying for the law. And there is, and I'm pointing at that because that's an interesting crossroad between Paul's say generally apostles who turns to the Jews and the others like Paul who turns to the Gentile, mm-hmm. who use the same language in the sense of this magnitude of this great event that happens with the coming of the Messiah and the abolition of the law, mm-hmm. which is simultaneously affecting both of them. And I'm pointing at that because, again, to try and to challenge this idea that there isn't a third community because of the ethnic relations. Because if there isn't, why is Paul so concerned that the Gentiles would affirm the commandments of the law?
Because it's important. First of all, he is telling them to fulfill the commandments of the law. He's not abolishing the law. He's telling them that since they have the Spirit, they can fulfill the law. He's very specific. He lists the commandments 6 through 10 in Romans 13. You know, telling them exactly, you know, no coveting, no adultery, no, I can't remember the rest of them, but he did. Part of what enables these people, part of his proof is that the ethne stop acting like ethne, because according to his biblical tropes, ethne are fornicating all the time and doing other terrible things, and now his group isn't.
So why does he find so agitating in the works of his rivals, of his apostolic rivals, to go to the Gentile, if he, as you say, approves the law?
I think because he's really committed to this particular paradigm of the ethne turning to the God of Israel, and he has been shaped in his mother's womb, he says in Galatians, precisely to talk to the ethne, and he's committed to this paradigm of ethne as ethne being incorporated into the kingdom of God.
But the difference between them and those who
and the, his
the law,
and the other and his rivals are saying they should become Jews. Now, did they say they should become Jews in the year 30, or was it only after the delay with the delay of the kingdom for 15 years? Did some people say, you know, these ethne who have made an exclusive commitment to the God of Israel have no place to be in the city. There's no place for them as Gentiles who are not worshiping Gentile gods to be in their cities. Let's stabilize the situation by turning them into Jews. That's an intra-Christian problem. I shouldn't use the word Christian.
When he turns his rival, is that ever directly an argument that he's saying, look, we have this model, this biblical model, and you're just ruining this model if you're trying to proselyte these Gentiles?
No, he says things about they should just cut off the whole thing. They're dogs and mutilators of the flesh. They're they don't understand anything. I myself was perfect in my law observance, but you know, grades don't matter. I mean, he says he throws everything but the kitchen sink. Does he throw Isaiah 2:2-4 at them? No.
And you don't think there's a possibility that this refers to the Jews who still perform the commandments? He of course also perform commandments, but to the non-believers in Christ, I mean, that his issue is with the possibility that they will go into the first group or the second group, whatever we want to call it, and not to his new congregation.
Is he worried about his congregation becoming circumcised?
Yes,
he is. That's what Galatians is about. But they would be doing so because they're listening to other Christian missionaries who are telling them that that's what they should do. And he's saying, ah, I had a fight like this years ago, and even Peter and James and John said I was right.
But don't we suddenly use too much the notion Christians?
It's almost the end of 2 hours, and I think terminology right. Slides.
Christians in scare quotes.
Yeah.
First of all, thank you very much for bringing up again family matters and ethnic matters, thinking about the individual. Mm-hmm. It seems now strange to us, if you're thinking about belief, that this could be something family-like or something ethnic. But first of all, you said it, that you don't even speak about the place of the nations to be annihilated, okay? okay, the censoring out, subjugatio or subverting the but I think to use another historical term, if you would think about that, Paul was bothered with the naturalization of the believers. Naturalization in modern terms means that someone is coming in your country, living for 10 years, and then the state is looking at what, how can we give these people the citizenship of this place. Mm-hmm. And someone like Paul, if you think about all the questions, is looking for naturalization of those who are believing in Christ or something, mm-hmm. something like this. And he looks for places in family terms, and he's not very much promoter of family life, I think, in person ways. He's speaking about national terms, ethnic terms, mm-hmm. but he's not a promoter of ethnos, mm-hmm. and so on. So in reading Paul in the second century, with another religious world around the Mediterranean, by all these unlocal rites of the second century, and the new way of seeing ethne in the Roman world, maybe that his discussion of leaving family behind, leaving ethnos behind, it was new red and has become a kind of term of conversion individually. But I think you convinced me, at least, that in this point, that the categories of family and the categories of ethnos for all are still very relevant and to understand. But thinking now, not speaking about conversion, but speaking mm-hmm. about Paul, thinking about naturalization. What can we do, how can we say about those people who are God-fearers plus believing only in the God of Israel and believing in the salvation through Christ? So how can we define them to build up a new community or to build a current community? And so using not conversion but naturalization would be our story in the same way. would maybe change
the... It's a different set of headaches. No, that works. Or you could consider his rivals who are pushing circumcision to be the ones who are trying to naturalize these ethne.
And naturalize. So this is a modern term, but maybe
The problem with the problem with I do Christian origins. There's another minion who work on these same texts, and they do New Testament studies. And part of the machloket here is, when can you use the word Christian? Because some people look at Paul as a Christian theologian who's inventing Christianity. And part of my caution and trying to mobilize these other texts is to try to free him of that particular role. As you were speaking, though, I couldn't help but think of the second century, partly, again, Yossi, because of your talking about when can we use conversion properly. In the second century, when different ex-pagan Gentiles are reading Paul to construct Christianity, Marcion, Valentinus, Justin Martyr, what they do is they take the high god of philosophy, who is not ethnic, who is not embodied, who is not a creator, who is this metaphysical punctum. And they say that is the high God who's the father of Jesus Christ. And this lower God who's depicted in Genesis, who's ethnic, who likes blood sacrifices, I mean, that's demons like blood sacrifices, who's so ethnically particular, is the God of the Jews. What is the relationship of this high God to the God of Genesis? And then it depends whom you speak to. Marcion says there's no relation. Justin says, oh, that lower God is Christ before the incarnation, as Isaiah realized. Isaiah realized that he was really talking about Christ when he was talking about the scriptural. So it's once you get a de-ethnicizing of the idea of God that comes in precisely from pagan intellectual traditions, and then that reconfigures the ethnicity of the story in a different way.
Paul had done it in Athens, no?
Pardon me? Right. look at this altar. Right, which is why Acts finally has the word Christian, I think, in it.
Okay, we have time for one last
one. Okay. I think one of the central things that has come up over and over again in today's discussion has been that we are arguing about conversion versus incorporation into a new sect, eschatological sect, Jew versus Judean, pagan versus Gentile. We're arguing about terminology a lot, but the important thing about that argument is that we are trying to recognize our own presuppositions that fog up our glasses from reading the text. It's far more difficult to look at the text if we just simply impose our cultural categories onto the text. The more we argue about Jew versus Judean, or convert versus someone who is incorporated into this new eschatological sect, the better we are able to try to get at what Paul is arguing. Second point under the same thing is Paul's arguments, the arguments Paul uses to persuade other people are not necessarily the argument, the reasons for which Paul is making the argument.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. You mean it's, I mean, there's a rhetorical shaping to, and a situation, and there's a situation we don't know anymore.
Yes, and so because of that, for example, I think your analysis that Paul in Galatians is saying don't get circumcised, so he's using arguments that he can use to the local community in words they can understand with categories that are contemporary, since it don't get circumcised. Why is that? Because of his own prophetic, Isaianic expectations of the end time people of God, composed of both the Jews who were the natural born citizens and the Gentiles who worship the God of Israel exclusively, who are there with them. So,
okay. I think we'll conclude here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.